coast and places like that. So these are issues that I think as we go through the local plan consultation, as you come back on these things as part of the general thing around the open spaces as well as the coast and the pressures on the European sites and the like, you might just need to have some thought on that and how that actually works and manages itself across the borough, because that is going to just become an increasing pressure. And the balance there, of course, is yes, you want to protect the coastline because it's a really unique asset and a fantastic environmental opportunity in terms of world. At the same time, we need to build houses for people to live in. You know, it's the balance of how we actually manage to do that and how we approach that in the way that we're going to articulate that in the local plan and what the thrust is. And obviously that's for members to decide what's gone through the consultation process and then you have the comments back. But it's just worth thinking about that as well. So that's slightly one of the issues.
Would this
sort of
be through the Committee of the Social Policies that we will?
No, what is likely to happen, planning application of a certain size require habitats regulation assessments, and those habitats regulation assessments are legal requirements. The council would be the body that would have to satisfy the HRA regulations. In terms of that legislation, you cannot bring into the consideration viability of schemes. So say you had a housing scheme of 100 units, they'd calculate what the impact of that was on your coastal recreation areas, and they'd work out a tariff, so say it was £100 per property, just making this up, so don't worry, but £100 per property. If that development was, say, in Birkenhead, then you wouldn't be able to take into account the viability, whether the scheme could afford it. It would have to just be found because we would have to legally comply with the HRA, because if you don't do that, it's a criminal offence. Yeah. So those are the types of issues that we just need to think through and work out a way of what our approach is going to be. Now, there's a number of options there. One is you can ask the developer to provide that, you can make it a requirement. The other approach is that the council could consider as part of its, let's call it a coastal or environmental strategy, of ways in which we might want to invest or attract other grant funding in to mitigate recreational pressures in coastal areas. And for us as the council or the public sector to look at that and manage those pressures, so that takes the pressure off the housing development doing that. Now this is all just emerging at the moment and there's nothing yet decided, but this is causing some issues. So you may recall when you considered the legacy planning application for the waters, there was a recreational tariff there that was agreed with Peel. It's outside of a clear policy framework at the moment, but one doesn't exist. But to satisfy the habitats regulation assessments, there was an arrangement done with Peel there. We did the same with Keymont on the Wolford Road scheme as well, if you recall. Now, we've managed to do both of those things very successfully, and it's all worked. But we will have a number of challenges on every residential development. I think it's something threshold is very low, but the geography of Wirral, when they apply this, it's within certain metres of the coast, and I think 99.9% of Wirral would fall within that area. It's a very small part of Bidston that is just a metre or so probably away from the target area. So I'm only raising it now, not maybe for a solution, but just to put it in your minds to think about, because we'll have to think about the balance of the approach to those issues with the pressures and how you want to balance that in the local plan and what you want your drivers to be in terms of Wirral in its future. Okay. So I went on there for a little bit, but it's just to give you that idea.
exactly what this committee, as a subcommittee, is for, is to see emerging regulations and emerging policies, understand them, it's a fair thing, you know, members of the planning committee need to do, and lead members of the planning groups need to do, and then agree, you know, give some detailed consideration to those policies and pass them to the decision-making structure that we have now and the one that will emerge after May, you know, in terms of how these will dovetail into our strategic planning policies and into our development control policies. So that was an interesting introduction to that. Are we content?
Yes.
I just wanted, just before we went, I think there was a question raised, possibly in our very second meeting, by Geoffrey's, what happens now? You know, we've sent Eddie with a lot of thoughts, and a few XXX is still up here and a lot of documentation. And we have a work programme now, February and March, so we have two subject areas still to cover. One will be, tell me what we're doing in March.
At the February meeting, we're looking at environmental protection, coastal protection, flood risk, pollution and risk, contamination, minerals and waste. And at the March meeting, we're looking at the retail hierarchies, developments within town centres, nighttime uses, impact assessments, and how you deal with the edge of centre issues and out of centre retail facilities.
Excellent. So they're the policies I'm going to do. In amongst this, the Audit and Risk Committee considered the peer review, which I think the members, Steve, you have been involved with discussions with the LDA when they came. And
yes, Peter, yeah.
So we're familiar with the same place. We're familiar also there's an action plan associated with that. The Audit and Risk Committee received it, considered it, and then sent it, if you like, back to us as the planning function. And the way the planning function currently works, we have the planning committee and we have the subcommittee, which is born of the planning committee. Now, my view has always been that the strategic stuff like this ought to be considered here while we've got, you know, the time, rather than tagged on to the end of a long planning agenda. I know that there's a difference in numbers, etc. Are members content? I mean, I can take this to the planning committee as well next week, if senior thinks that's appropriate. Are members content to senior
proposals?
I think it may also depend on how the remit of the planning committee and whether it's the planning subcommittee or the strategic planning committee come out with the new proposals. So I think that will clarify at this point as well.
I didn't want to lose sight of the peer review this side of, if you like, the end of the municipal year. Yeah. I thought that for now, it sits here until this body, if you like, morphs into the more strategic committee as part of the because we're going to have to start thinking about how we engage on strategic plan applications and the scheme of delegation to make it, because there's a lot coming down the, you know, the pipe. I know we've criticised ourselves in the past because we've sat as a planning committee. George mentioned this, sat as a planning with a large application, which, you know, we support, and we should have just been getting on with building, you know, the houses, but we need a way of ensuring that lead members in the planning forum are aware of large applications, are aware of what the issues are, without the need for it to necessarily find its way through. You know, and that lies in the scheme of delegation, doesn't it? I mean, obviously there's objections in those petitions. Fine, that's the job of the planning committee to make those balances. But, you know, liaising with developers as well, you know, we need to be talking with developers at a member level. And it needs a smaller group of members to do that as we move forward. So I appreciate they're two big meaty items, but I don't want to lose sight of the LGA
and or if there was a view that there would, that it might be helpful for that to be considered by a smaller group of members to feed back information to you, then that's certainly something that could be done by the planning committee or by this subcommittee with your approval. And I think if it was going to be this subcommittee, I think we would have to take that to planning committee as well for them to agree to that. But you're right, because up until May, you retain overall responsibility for the peer review.
Yeah, but and at the same time, the planning committee is making the planning application decisions, and it needs in its own right to have certainty, you know, about the modernisation of planning services, doesn't it? But I think I'm not sensing disagreement. I'm just sensing that you want to put on record that there's a decision making process is what it is, but there is still oversight going on a more wider basis, and I understood that to be the policy in the registration as well.
Thank you.